Back in August 2021, I made a video looking at a new publication from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. That report was the first in a series of three, and it focused on the physical science that defines the extent of our current climate emergency. The second of the three reports has just been published. This one explains the climate impacts on human societies and the natural world, drawing on evidence from more than 14,000 peer-reviewed scientific studies from all over the planet. And I'm bound to tell you, it makes for pretty grim reading. The report finds that climate change is already killing human beings, destroying nature, and making the world poorer. The meeting of 20,000 delegates at COP26 in Glasgow last year completely failed to put the world on track to reduce greenhouse gas emissions in line with safe levels of warming. And we've now gone past many of the tipping points that scientists have been warning us about for decades. That means that in many cases, the damages we'll see in the coming years will go beyond levels that humans and nature can adapt to. So are we completely out of time, or is there a glimmer of hope that we can salvage something from the coming wreckage? Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. If you've not come across the IPCC before, they're the United Nations climate science body, made up of hundreds of the world's top climate scientists. They issue a set of major assessment reports every few years that review tens of thousands of peer-reviewed papers to reach consensus on the most up-to-date state of knowledge about climate change. The fundamental framework for all IPCC reports is risk, because although, as many skeptics very enthusiastically point out, it's impossible to give absolute cast-iron guarantees of what the climate will be like in 10, 20, or even 80 years' time, it is possible to give a very accurate assessment of the level of impact that climate change has already had on our planet, and modern science can now provide us with very robust ranges of projected future outcomes so that policymakers can start to assess the risks and either make radical changes to avoid those risks or start planning the logistics and contingencies that they'll need to have in place in the next few years in order to adapt and survive. Which, by the way, is what COP26 in Glasgow in November 2021 was all about, and why it was such a disappointing failure, as I outlined in another video that you can jump back to by clicking up there somewhere. The IPCC visualises those risks and their causes and consequences on a sort of anti-wheel of fortune. At the centre of the wheel are the interconnected variables of climate hazards, vulnerability and exposure of human systems, ecosystems and biodiversity. They're all interconnected, of course, so you get this kind of overlapping Venn diagram of doom. We've known for decades that human society, especially Western human society, has been releasing increasingly larger amounts of greenhouse gases. Those emissions are causing changes in our climate, and those changes have damaging impacts to humans and to Earth's natural systems. We humans are also directly impacting nature through widespread changes in land use for things like agriculture, mining and logging. So the ecosystems that human beings and all other species rely on for survival are getting clobbered from all angles. We're only now starting to panic a bit and think globally about adaptation, and some of those adaptations may actually be doing more harm than good, which is why this word maladapts appears in red. More about that later. Nature is also starting to respond to the changing climate, but the climate is now changing so quickly that losses and damage are inevitable and unavoidable in the coming years. That is, I think, what you might call a vicious circle. The virtuous circle that the IPCC are urging us all to move towards as quickly as possible looks more like this. A transition in human systems will mean that our species will no longer be a net emitter of greenhouse gases. Our adaptations will be carefully considered and targeted instead of knee-jerk and reactionary. That'll begin to reduce the damaging impacts on our way of life and on nature's ecosystems. Those ecosystems will respond by becoming healthier and more sustainable, providing the essential life support systems for us humans and the millions of other species we share the planet with. Human development will become climate resilient, focused on human health and well-being, as well as equity and justice, and there will be equal emphasis on ecosystem and planetary health. Now, listening to that last bit, you might think I'm about to break into a rendition of Kumbaya. So let's just bring ourselves back down to earth again and remind ourselves of the size of the challenge that this latest report sets out. Our lives and livelihoods are dependent on ecosystems and species that provide people with food and water in different parts of the world. All of them are being impacted in some way by climate change. Although those impacts obviously vary from one region to another, as an overall global picture, every single sector is now experiencing a high level of climate impact. And it's not just the warmer mid-latitude regions, as you might think. In fact, if you drop down the list, it turns out that it's actually Europe and North America that are the two regions where a high level of impact is affecting all natural systems. We're already witnessing more and more heat waves, flooding, droughts, and wildfires on land, plus extreme hotspots in our oceans. The IPCC tells us that many of those events are resulting in increasingly irreversible losses. More people are dying as a result, and essential forestry land is being destroyed not just by fire, but by drought as well. Ocean heat is causing coral bleaching, which is destroying reefs and all the rich marine biodiversity that they support. Marine kelp forests, which pound for pound can capture and store far more carbon dioxide than land-based forests, are disappearing at an alarming rate. Approximately half of all marine species assessed globally are now shifting towards the poles to escape the uninhabitable warm waters at mid-latitudes. And on land, a similar proportion of species are moving to higher elevations. Sea level rise has made hurricanes and tropical cyclones more severe, with all the related losses and damages that they bring. Hundreds of species have already been pushed to extinction, and thousands more are being brought to the brink all the time as each year goes by. The impacts on the planet's hydrological systems are approaching irreversibility as a result of retreating glaciers and changes in mountain and Arctic ecosystems driven by permafrost thaw. Since the last IPCC report in 2014, the data show much more clearly that it's human-induced climate change that's causing the increases in frequency and severity of all these extreme events. And the extent and magnitude of climate change impacts are larger than estimated in any previous assessment. As in previous reports, the IPCC use what they call shared socioeconomic pathways, or SSPs, to provide projections for likely future outcomes. These numbers represent watts per square meter of average warming across the entire planet. It's what the science bods refer to as radiative forcing. That radiative forcing currently sits at about 3.2 watts per square meter. If we carry on as we are, we could reach a warming level of 8.5 watts per square meter by the end of the century. And in that scenario, all of the IPCC's rather diplomatically titled reasons for concern go pretty much off the charts. Average global temperatures will be up to about 5 degrees Celsius. Kelp forests, warm water corals, seagrass meadows and salt marshes will almost completely disappear. Impacts on terrestrial and freshwater systems will be equally catastrophic, and global human death from heat stroke, UV exposure, and diseases like malaria, dengue, and others will be out of control. Even if we manage to slow the increase right down and limit ourselves to the mid-range scenario of SSP2, the projections still show that we're in pretty big trouble. The most recent studies show that if global warming exceeds 1.5 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels, even if we only overshoot that limit briefly, then some of these impacts will themselves cause the release of yet more greenhouse gases, and some of them will be irreversible, even if we somehow manage to reduce global warming later on in the century. So are we likely to exceed 1.5 degrees? Well, we're currently sitting at 1.2 degrees, and global greenhouse gas emissions would have to be halved by 2030 if we're to stand any chance of avoiding that temperature overshoot. Right now, global greenhouse gas emissions are increasing each year, not decreasing. I'll let you come to your own conclusions on that one. So this latest IPCC summary places far greater emphasis than previous reports on how we can fundamentally adapt our societal behaviours and infrastructure to cope with what's coming our way in the next few decades. Those changes will affect every aspect of human life on Earth, from land and ocean ecosystems, with things like improved coastal defences and better management of coastal ecosystems like mangroves, through to much more environmentally intelligent design for our urban environments, where two-thirds of the world's population will be living by 2050. Governments will need to prioritise funding for root and branch improvements to national and international infrastructure and transition our energy systems away from fossil fuels and onto renewable technologies. And perhaps most poignantly of all, given the current state of world affairs, it'll be crucial for world leaders to work hand in hand to ensure peace and facilitate human mobility. That's not some idealistic hippie aspiration. The fact is that millions of people are going to be displaced from uninhabitable regions and also as a result of regional conflicts for increasingly scarce resources. If we fight amongst ourselves, then we can pretty much be assured of mutual destruction sooner or later. But if we find a way to genuinely work together as an international community, then we might just achieve an orderly and planned relocation and resettlement of what could be as much as a third of our global population. And along the way, we need to ensure we don't make adaptations that cause more harm than good. That's that maladaptation word that we saw earlier. Since the last IPCC report in 2014, there's increasing evidence that these maladaptive responses are on the increase. They're often a product of short-term, knee-jerk reactions by governments and organisations keen to demonstrate that they're taking some sort of action against climate change without the necessary due diligence and thought about potential longer-term consequences. For example, say the IPCC, while building a seawall is a great idea for reducing the impacts on a coastal town in the short term, it might end up locking in increased levels of exposure to climate risks in the long term if it's not properly integrated into a longer-term climate mitigation and development plan. Equally, measures to achieve fire suppression in naturally fire-adapted ecosystems, while no doubt well-meaning, might turn out to be completely counterproductive by reducing the space needed for natural processes, which in turn could severely degrade the local ecosystem. Likewise, planting trees, which is very much the on-trend action of choice that many Westerners believe to be the cure-all to save our skins. In some cases, it may well be a useful thing to do, but indiscriminately planting trees wherever there's a bit of available space could be disastrous. If that patch of land has never had trees on it before, then the chances are it's not well suited for them, and the newly planted trees will probably die. Or they might survive in a region that was previously providing an important level of reflectiveness, or albedo, and once the tree canopies cover over all the ground, that albedo is lost. And of course, these sorts of well-meaning developments might also impact negatively on the lives and livelihoods of already very vulnerable indigenous people, who are almost always the ones who cop for the consequences of policies and actions imposed upon them by us Westerners. There's no suggestion here that initiatives like tree planting are inherently bad. The point is, they need to be thought through extremely carefully before we go bowling in like a bull in a china shop. What we're after, as this chart shows, is as high a level of climate resilient development as possible. According to the IPCC, we've already missed a bunch of opportunities as a global community to reach the very highest level, which they represent with this dotted line. There'll also be climatic and non-climatic shocks along the way, like the COVID pandemic and, of course, the current conflict in Ukraine. Those shocks will put significant wobbles in the development lines. If we choose to continue with our current levels of consumption and greenhouse gas emissions, then we're on a race to the bottom. But, say the IPCC, if the right cumulative choices and actions are made by governments, commerce, and civil society to engage with adaptation, mitigation, and development actions in areas of policy, economy, ecology, social culture, and technology, then there is still a small window of opportunity to drag ourselves back up to a level at which we can survive and thrive. That window is rapidly narrowing, though, according to the IPCC report. Our global carbon budget gives us fewer than 8 years of emissions left at current rates. So we really have reached the end of the road down which we've been kicking the metaphorical can for about the last 3 or 4 decades or so. Time's up. That's it for this week. As always, a huge thank you to the channel's amazing Patreon supporters who help me keep these videos completely independent and ad-free. And you can find out all about how to get involved with that at patreon.com/justhaveathink. And of course, the best and easiest way you can really support the channel via YouTube completely for free is by clicking the subscribe button and giving us a like and share. It really does make a huge difference, and it's dead easy to do. You just need to click down there or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week if you can, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.